Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Racial Melancholia, Racial Dissociation, on the Social and Psychic Lives of Asian Americans, by David L. Eng and Shinhee Han, narrated by Cindy Kay. Preface. We are bombarded today by celebratory discourses of multiculturalism and diversity in the face of intensifying racial discord and violence. In our punitively colorblind age, we lack sufficient critical resources to analyze and explore the social and psychic conditions that give rise to such contradictions. In particular, we have few conceptual frameworks to understand their social and psychic effects on Asian Americans. Racial Melancholia, Racial Dissociation attempts to provide a theoretical account of these paradoxes of race. The numerous case histories and commentaries on Asian American adolescents and young adults that comprise this book were written over 20 years. The present volume is the culmination of a comprehensive rethinking and rewriting of our various ideas about the social and psychic lives of Asian American students and patients we have encountered in the classroom and clinic across two generations, from Generation X to Generation Y. As a Chinese American humanities professor and Korean American psychotherapist, we have worked together to reconceptualize psychoanalytic theory in relation to specific historical moments and times. That is, to consider the shifting history of the Asian American subject in relation to the evolving subject of Asian American history. From the wake of the Cold War and civil rights movements, to our current colorblind age under neoliberalism and globalization, we consider how psychic processes of racial melancholia and racial disassociation track and name the various ways by which Asian Americans in particular, and other people of color in general, are assimilated into, as well as excluded from, the social and political domains. Having composed this book over the course of two decades, we have accumulated numerous debts of gratitude for the insights, friendships, and support we received along the way. First and foremost, we would like to thank Calvin Chin, Maria Josefina Saldana Portillo, Karen Shimakawa, and Michelle Stevens for their brilliance and generosity. These four wonderful friends and colleagues participated in a manuscript workshop in 2016 that, along with the laser beam insights of the magnificent Hirokazu Yoshikawa, transformed the theoretical structure and overall framing of this book at a crucial moment of its conceptualization. Over many years, Hiro, Josie, Calvin, as well as Ed Cohen, Neve Gordon, Janice Gump, Jack Halberstam, Amy Kaplan, Suvir Kaul, David Kazanjian, Homei King, Anya Lumba, Suzette Min, the late Jose Esteban Munoz, Mei Nye, A. Naomi Paik, Anne Pellegrini, Camille Robsis, Catherine Rottenberg, Melissa Sanchez, Shuang Shen, Shu Mei Shi, Melanie Suchet, Joan Scott, Kaja Silverman, Serena Volp, Priscilla Wald, Dorothy Wang, and Truming Young served as delightful and steadfast interlocutors for this project. Dylan Werner Christ provided exemplary support with research, as did Derek Gottlieb with indexing. As always, Temu Ruskola was consistently present to think, support, cajole, and edit. The late Muriel Diamond's intellectual vision, as embodied in the journal she helped to found, Studies in Gender and Sexuality, Psychoanalysis, Cultural Studies, Treatment, Research, has been an invaluable source of inspiration for us across theoretical and clinical domains. An earlier version of Chapter 2 appeared in Studies in Gender and Sexuality, and an earlier version of Chapter 1 appeared in Psychoanalytic Dialogues. We're grateful to these journals for providing an early home for our work. At an important juncture in the writing of the last half of this project, Danielle Allen facilitated an excellent reading group at the Institute for Advanced Study in 2013 on what eventually became part two and the final couple chapters exploring the topic of racial dissociation. In conjunction, we would like to acknowledge the Institute for Psychoanalytic Training and Research in New York City, and, in particular, Michael Moskowitz and Ben Kafka, for their invitation in 2015 to reflect on the collaborations we have published over the years concerning psychoanalysis, race, and Asian Americans. Indeed, the warm welcome and encouragement we received at IPTAR motivated us to complete this book. In this context, Patricia Garavici has been an especially thoughtful and stimulating interlocutor. Over the past two decades in which these case histories and commentaries were written, we have given numerous presentations and workshops, together and singly, at various universities, institutes, conferences, clinics, and community-based organizations. They're too numerous to name here separately, but we would like to express our deep gratitude to the multiple organizers and audiences whose serious engagement with the lives recounted and analyzed here has made our thinking all the better. To our knowledge, Racial Melancholia, Racial Dissociation, is the first monograph to bring together psychoanalytic theory and case histories with critical race studies and law. Moreover, it is the first co-authored book written across the domain of the clinic and the field of the humanities, deploying as its primary source materials original case histories and commentaries on Asian Americans in a comparative racial context. That is, while the book is a timely and necessary expansion of psychoanalysis in relation to race, and vice versa, the project also insistently triangulates polarized black-white binaries of race and racism that often exclude Asian Americans and other people of color from critical analysis altogether. Most of all, then, we would like to thank our students and patients for sharing with us their invaluable experiences and their courageous admissions of vulnerability, which are at the heart of this book, and without which the project would simply not exist. We have been careful to disguise their identities. We have changed names, family backgrounds, hometowns, majors, and schools for the people described and discussed here. When at all possible, consent was received from those students and patients we were able to contact. Nonetheless, each case study incorporates aspects of not only one particular student or patient, but also at times other students and patients who share similar experiences and dilemmas. In Chapter 1, case histories of Elaine and Nelson are composites of various students that we counseled, both in private practice and in the university clinic, and taught in our various Asian American lectures and seminars at the beginning of our careers. In Chapter 2, the case history of Mina, a transnational adoptee from Korea, was written and published with her consent, as were the two case histories of Christopher and Neil, gay parachute children from China and India, in Chapter 4. The case histories on Yuna and Jung, two other parachute children from Korea and China, composing Chapter 3, are masked descriptions. Both Yuna and Jung were treated in university settings for brief periods, and it was impossible to locate either of them to obtain their consent, as their two case histories were composed long after their school files were sealed. All the students who agreed to be included in this book expressed a common hope that the pain underlying their distinctive social and psychic predicaments might somehow help other Asian Americans struggling in silence with similar troubles and crises. This, of course, is our hope as well. Many thanks to Kusama Studio and the David Zwirner Gallery for permitting the use of our striking cover image. Yayoi Kusama's art and her life as an Asian immigrant/migrant in New York City. She arrived in 1957 at age 27 and returned to Tokyo in 1973. Anticipate in provocative ways many of the themes of this book, last but proverbially not least. we would like to offer deep thanks to our longtime editor, Ken Wissaker, and to Julianne Alexander, Elizabeth Alt, Mary Ho, Sarah Leone, and the other staff members at Duke University Press for their inveterate support of emerging, necessary, and difficult new scholarship in both psychoanalysis and critical race studies. We could not imagine publishing this book with anyone or anywhere else. Introduction: The History of the Racial Subject and the Subject of Racial History. Racial Melancholia, Racial Dissociation represents an extensive and evolving collaboration that has lasted for 2 decades. This book is the result of a comprehensive reframing and rewriting of our various ideas about the social and psychic lives of Asian American adolescents and young adults we have encountered in the classroom and clinic across 2 generations, from Generation X to Generation Y. Over time, we have witnessed firsthand the shifting demographics, as well as the remarkable psychic transformations of our students and patients in the face of an ever-growing politics of colorblindness in U.S. society and a rising Asia under neoliberalism and globalization. In this project, we present 2 distinct psychic mechanisms by which racialized immigrant subjects process problems of discrimination, exclusion, loss, and grief: racial melancholia and racial dissociation. We use the term racial melancholia to refer to histories of racial loss that are condensed into a forfeited object whose significance must be deciphered and unraveled for its social meanings. Racial dissociation, in contrast, refers to histories of racial loss that are dispersed across a wide social terrain, histories whose social origins and implications remain insistently diffuse and obscure. We developed our theory of racial melancholia in the late 1990s in relation to Generation X, those born between 1960 and 1980. As we encountered a new cohort of students and patients, millennials from Generation Y, those born between 1980 and 2000, we came to realize the historical and demographic specificity of our understanding of racial melancholia. Our novel theory of racial dissociation, to our knowledge, we are the first to explore the concept comprehensively, represents our attempt to understand, describe, and navigate the changing social and psychic landscape of race, racism, and race relations in the United States. We, a second-generation Chinese-American male professor in the humanities, and a 1.5-generation Korean-American female psychotherapist, originally met at Columbia University, where we worked in the mid-1990s in the Department of English and Comparative Literature and in Counseling and Psychological Services, respectively. A spate of suicides by Asian American students and the gruesome murder of an Asian American law student by a former boyfriend brought us together in collective sorrow. This grief was exacerbated by a feeling on the part of our students and patients that there was, and continues to be, little acknowledgement or understanding of the social violence and psychic pain afflicting Asian American communities. This fact is as true on the part of administrators, faculty, and students as it is, most poignantly, on the part of ourselves. Indeed, the regnant model minority myth, which we analyze and discuss throughout this book, persistently represents Asian Americans as nerdy automatons, technically gifted in math and sciences, continuously working, compliant, wealthy, and exempt from discrimination. Asian Americans, in fact, have the highest poverty rate of any racial group in New York City. More often than not, racism against Asian Americans occurs without recognition and without provoking any serious outcry or protest. Significantly, Asian American is an expansive term. it describes American-born citizens, as well as foreign-born immigrants, and citizens living in the United States from disparate national, geographic, cultural, education, class, and religious backgrounds, who trace their ancestry to East Asia, South Asia, or Southeast Asia. Although students and patients tend to identify with their particular racial or ethnic group, a long history of discrimination is what binds Asian Americans together as a collective. And the adoption of a coalitional Asian American identity is often a conscious, politicized choice. Paradoxically, while Asian Americans are always included in diversity statistics, they are largely excluded from affirmative action programs. A significant point of controversy in ongoing national debates concerning the politics of race and colorblindness. In short, we are seen as a homogeneous and self-sufficient community with no particular need of assistance or support. This stereotype is the dominant way we are perceived, socially fixed and psychically formed as subjects. It is woefully inadequate to understanding the circumstances of our various social and psychic predicaments. Some months after the last funeral at Columbia, we began to discuss the death of one of the students, Shirley Yoon, a popular and well-known senior whose suicide in 1998 affected both of us deeply, though neither of us knew her personally. On reflection, her death was the emotional culmination in a series of unbearable losses the community suffered that year. Although dozens of students and family members participated in her burial service on Long Island, we, along with the university chaplain, an African-American woman, were among the few representatives of the university in attendance. We found this deeply unsettling. In trying to come to terms with Shirley Yoon's passing, we became absorbed with one particular line in Freud's essay on mourning and melancholia, in which he writes that the melancholic knows whom he has lost, but not what he has lost in him. In contrast to what he initially describes as healthy mourning, Freud characterizes melancholia as a type of pathological mourning without end, in which the significance of the lost object remains unconscious and opaque. In yet other cases, one feels justified in maintaining the belief that a loss of this melancholic kind occurred. But one cannot see clearly what it is that has been lost, and it is all the more reasonable to suppose that the patient cannot consciously perceive what he has lost either. This, indeed, might be so, even if the patient is aware of the loss which has given rise to his melancholia, but only in the sense that he knows whom he has lost, but not what he has lost in him. In trying to understand what we had lost in Shirley Yoon, we eventually co-authored an article titled A Dialogue on Racial Melancholia. That case history and commentary explored Freud's concept of melancholia in relation to depression and suicide among Asian American college students. And it sought to connect their interminable sadness with difficulties arising from immigration, assimilation, and the racialization they face on a daily basis. A Dialogue on Racial Melancholia was originally published in 2000. In the clinical journal Psychoanalytic Dialogues. It comprises the first half of the title we have chosen for this book, as it represents our initial joint endeavor to rethink both psychoanalytic theory and clinical practice, so that they might be more useful for analyzing problems of race and racism for Asian Americans and other communities of color. In this book, we argue that what we describe as racial melancholia among Generation X and racial dissociation among Generation Y constitute two psychic mechanisms by which these different generations process social predicaments associated with discrimination and exclusion, as well as psychic difficulties connected to loss and grief. Importantly, by considering histories of immigration, assimilation, and racialization, as well as stereotypes such as the model minority myth and yellow peril, in terms of Asian American subject formation across two generations. We reconceptualize psychoanalytic theory in relation to specific historical moments and times. Throughout the book, we investigate the history of the racial subject in relation to the subject matter of racial history. In this project, psychoanalytic theory is our primary theoretical tool for exploring the shifting history of the racial subject, while critical race theory is our primary theoretical tool for analyzing the evolving subject of racial history. That is, insofar as loss and grief are generated by juridico-political mechanisms configuring a long history of Asian American immigration and exclusion, the book pays particular attention to critical race theory's insights on law, structural racism, systematic bias, and social violence as a necessary supplement to our psychoanalytic investigation of the Asian American subject. From Cold War discourse and the legacy of the civil rights movement shaping Generation X's coming of age, to our current colorblind moment under neoliberalism and globalization shaping Generation Y's coming of age, we consider how racial melancholia and racial dissociation identify and trace distinctive patterns by which Asian Americans and other people of color are assimilated into, as well as excluded from, the social and political domains. In addition to depression, suicide, and racial melancholia among model minorities, Chapter 1, we write about the politics of mothering and racial reparation in the practice of transnational adoption, Chapter 2. Racial dissociation, psychic nowhere, and the displacement of parachute children with the rise of Asia under neoliberalism and globalization, Chapter 3, and panic attacks and the politics of coming out for gay Asian parachute children in a colorblind age, Chapter 4. We bring together different schools and paradigms of psychoanalytic thought, legal histories of race and racism, and the politics of Asian immigration and exclusion with the aim of creating a more sustained conversation about the lives of Asian Americans and Asians in the diaspora. In retrospect, we have been investigating for two decades what might be described as the social and psychic structures of a comparatively privileged class of Asian American adolescents and young adults in the private and public U.S. institutions of higher education, trying to recognize, narrate, and come to terms with what they have lost, as well as gained, in immigration, migration, displacement, and diaspora. It is worth emphasizing that we do not presume to represent all Asian American subjects in this project. Nonetheless, we hope the specific case histories and commentaries of the particular students and patients presented here will shine critical light on some general social and psychic dilemmas that many Asian Americans endure. Thus, we hope to forge links among various groups to develop new critical approaches, clinical responsibilities, and political coalitions. The measured pace of our collaboration is due in part to the vicissitudes of our professional and personal lives, but it also stems from the comparative isolation of psychoanalysis and critical race studies as intellectual areas of inquiry largely independent from one another. On the one hand, race and racism are often conceptualized as sociological phenomena, and problems of material inequality that have little to do with the formation of the psyche. As conventional psychoanalytic theory places sexuality at the heart of the development of individual subjectivity, it has relegated race to the periphery, as sociology, in Kimberlyn Leary's words, outside the purview of psychoanalysis altogether, or important only as categories of experience if translated into the metric of sexual desire or the vicissitudes of family life. Farhod Dalil notes that, insofar as psychoanalytic theory typically approaches social conflict in the external world as a reflection of psychic distress in the internal world, racism is rarely conceptualized as an effect of larger social histories and cultural practices. Rather, it is seen as the result of individual neuroses, phobias, and prejudices. Psychoanalytic theory has consistently privileged the internal psychic world over the external social world. It has insistently focused on the private realm of family and kinship relations over the public realm of law and politics. And it has largely configured the internal psychic functionings of subjectivity as extraneous to the external world of the social. Broadly speaking, both psychoanalytic theorists and clinicians have been slow to examine how histories of race and colonial modernity implicitly frame their field's evolution, its dominant paradigms and theoretical assumptions. Even today, the overwhelming majority of clinical case histories refer only to a patient's personal family history and interpersonal family dynamics, rather than to the subject of racial history writ large. Social, political, legal, economic, and cultural factors are bracketed in the analysis of the history of the racial subject and the etiology of psychic pain. Put otherwise, psychoanalysis is focused on the mother, but rarely considers the motherland. It is attuned to family dynamics, but rarely thinks about the family of nations. On the other hand, agendas in critical race studies have largely been governed by sociological, legal, and empirical accounts of race and racial subordination as material inequality, as a problem of political rights and representation, as well as economic redistribution and justice. As a result, the field has not adequately considered how psychoanalysis as a critical heuristic for understanding how racial subjectivity is formed and created, and race relations are reproduced and sustained as intertwined material and psychic phenomena. For instance, we argue in part two of this book that as race continues to slip into the collective unconscious in a colorblind age, the importance of a psychoanalytic approach that can frame and analyze the political stakes of this significant historical shift, the unconscious and hidden symptoms of what Stokely Carmichael and Charles V. Hamilton call institutional racism, only intensifies. Similarly, in its largely domestic focus on the history of U.S. constitutional law and black-white race relations, the field of critical race studies has not adequately explored new demographic trends among Asian Americans and other immigrants of color, such as transnational adoptees and parachute children. They are generally absent from analyses of race and racism. At the same time, scholarly focus in critical race and ethnic studies on problems of group discrimination often overlooks critical insights provided by studying the predicaments of individual subjectivity. Such an exploration is not only the hallmark of psychoanalytic practice and the case history, but also, at times, the harbinger of or impediment to an emergent political consciousness. Indeed, what Raymond Williams might describe as an emergent social formation and a will for historical change. In slightly different terms, when identifying with others, the individual is also invariably attaching him or herself to larger group histories, as well as social categories and collectives. It is crucial, then, for both psychoanalytic and critical race theory to consider at once the psychic and social mechanisms of this interchange between the individual and the collective. From this perspective, the book is centrally concerned with psychoanalytic debates over the biological nature of the drives in terms of the actual social relations forming our psychic identifications with, attachments to, and investments in racial others. Racial melancholia, racial dissociation, thus begins with the idea that race and racism are complex phenomena operating in and through social and cultural norms. That histories of race and racism must be approached as both a cause and an effect of individual subjectivity, agency, and will. Throughout the project, we employ insights from critical race theory, a branch of scholarship that grew out of the 1980s Legal Academy. Critical race theory explores how law purports to represent abstract and equal liberal subjects, while in fact, producing racial subjects and hierarchies according to institutionalized structures of white power and privilege. Historically, the law has codified racial identity as an instrument of both political exclusion and economic exploitation. But at the same time, it has refused to recognize group claims, embedding legal rights, recognition, and responsibility exclusively in the figure of the abstract individual, and in relation to individual agency and intent. Today, the mandates of neoliberalism and an ever-shrinking public sphere, the idea of entrepreneurial spirit justifies discrimination and racism, social inclusion and exclusion, as functions of economic rationality and private choice. In the process, neoliberalism conscripts law and politics to its instrumental logic of individual self-sufficiency, a topic we explore at length in regard to Generation Y in part 2 of this book. Throughout this project, we also employ insights from the humanities and interpretive social sciences in order to situate our legal histories and cultural paradigms in relation to a troubled global history of colonialism, liberalism, and race, binding together Europe and the Americas with Asia and Africa. Finally, we also turn to a number of authors, artists, and directors whose creative works offer alternative ways of narrating and thus understanding racial history in relation to psychic pain. Indeed, a humanities-based approach to psychoanalysis highlights the political and therapeutic dimensions of narration. Literary, historical, and psychoanalytic practices all converge in their potential to tell the story differently, with narration functioning as a kind of individual and collective talking cure in the face of the vicissitudes of law and politics. In the past 2 decades, a small but growing number of influential books and articles exploring psychoanalysis and race have appeared in both the humanities and the clinical arena. At the same time, there are a handful of publications in the field of critical race studies considering the place of psychoanalysis in jurisprudence. Rarely, however, are humanities scholars and clinicians engaged in a sustained conversation about questions of race in psychoanalytic texts, case histories, clinical practices, classroom dynamics, cultural productions, and the larger social world. Even more rarely does this conversation focus specifically on the social and psychic lives of Asian Americans. To our knowledge, this is the first collaborative book written across the domain of the clinic and the field of the humanities, deploying as its primary source materials original case histories and commentaries on Asian Americans. At the same time that this project is an expansion of psychoanalysis in relation to race and vice versa, it also triangulates polarized black-white binaries of race and racism that often exclude Asian Americans and other people of color from critical analysis altogether, analyzing them instead in a comparative racial context. In sum, racial melancholia, racial dissociation, is committed to exploring how a more speculative, humanities-based approach to psychoanalytic theory might supplement its clinical applications, and vice versa. In the context of race, racism, immigration, and diaspora, all of which remain under-theorized across various disciplinary deployments of psychoanalysis, such a critical endeavor continues to be especially urgent. As various race and post-colonial scholars have noted, psychoanalytic theory and practice remain largely unaware of their historical conditions of emergence and untroubled by the particular European colonial tradition by which they are framed and in which they inevitably participate. At the same time, the lack of understanding in both Asian American and mainstream society of problems of social violence and psychic pain afflicting our communities demands a psychoanalytic vocabulary as one powerful conceptual tool, though not the only one, for critical analysis and change. The history of the racial subject has an ongoing and intimate connection to the subject of racial history. And it is this complex and shifting relationship that the book explores across two decades. The remainder of this introduction is organized into three sections. The first section examines the subject of racial history through the idea of race as relation and what Cheryl Harris describes as a long history of whiteness as property in U.S. law and jurisprudence, tracing its origins to the establishment of the U.S. nation-state through indigenous dispossession and the transatlantic slave trade. We start with the premise that race is not a thing as it is commonly understood, an unchanging biological trait, a bodily attribute, a difference of blood quantum or color, a static identity, a reflection of a natural order. Rather, we argue that race is a relation, a continuous modulating historical relationship among subjects mediated by socio-legal processes of social inclusion and exclusion. Race is as much about skin color and physiological markings as it is about a wide range of disparate social and psychic experiences of segregation and assimilation, absence and belonging, integration and dissociation, inclusion and exclusion. While the first section does not directly engage with psychoanalytic theory, it provides a theoretical base from which to consider how U.S. histories of race and racial conflict illuminate and reflect some fundamental concepts in psychoanalysis regarding problems of subject-object relations. The second section of this introduction extends psychoanalytic theories of subject-object relations by exploring how race as relation and whiteness as property shape and configure the history of the racial subject. For instance, by describing race as processes of social inclusion and exclusion, we can reconfigure psychoanalytic theories concerning the nature of the drives and the constitution of subjectivity in similar terms. We are able to analyze our privileged objects of identification and desire as articulated in and through social norms and relations, in and through historically contingent ideals and prohibitions, rather than as unmediated representations of biological instincts divorced from larger social histories and lived realities. We examine how race as relation and whiteness as property reconfigure universal paradigms in psychoanalytic theory, such as the Oedipus complex and its privileged subject-object dynamics, while also investigating the intricate social and psychic transactions that work to support what the Swedish Nobel laureate Gunnar Myrdal labeled in 1944 as an American dilemma. Myrdal describes this dilemma as the nation's paradoxical belief in the abstract equality of all American citizen subjects in the face of a long history of racial disparity and despair. In short, we consider how a repurposed psychoanalytic theory might provide powerful analytic tools for investigating the production of racial subjectivity and subordination, as well as race relations and segregation in the United States, from which neither spaces of the clinic nor the classroom are exempt. As Dorothy E. Holmes observes, the space of the clinic, and the university we would emphasize, are no less prone than any other to keeping issues of race repressed and unanalyzed. The third part of the introduction employs our critical discussions of the history of the racial subject and the subject of racial history to frame the four internal chapters, the case histories and critical commentaries, of this book in terms of the psychic mechanisms of racial melancholia and racial dissociation. Critical race theory and the subject of racial history. Race is a social relation with a long history in the United States. Modern genealogies of race trace themselves to the era of European colonization, and in particular, to the transatlantic slave trade, its biologization and commodification of human life. The peculiar institution of slavery associated with the United States and with ideas of U.S. exceptionalism has configured the problem of race as a particularly American phenomenon, an American dilemma. The displacement of race from Europe to the Americas, along with the coterminous affirmation of a universal European liberal subject through the forgetting of indigenous dispossession in the Americas, as well as the exploitation and exportation of human life from Africa and later Asia, necessitates a more serious engagement with global histories of race attached to modern empire, European and otherwise, its tactics of colonial settlement, and its circulation of bodies, goods, and ideas of difference. In the context of the United States, the phenomenon of chattel slavery has often constituted the history of race as a problem of white-black objectification. After all, slaves were literally commodities, part of a slave ship's cargo manifest, and insurable as such, like any other goods. In the process, chattel slavery also helped to shape the idea of race itself as an object, as a thing, an unchanging identity, a fixed biological trait, a scientific difference of blood quantum and gradients of color immediately visible on the body and apprehensible to the naked eye, an ontology with attendant ideas of mind and matter, civilization and savagery, freedom and unfreedom, that helped to justify the colonial enterprise and highly profitable business of enslaving other human beings. We might characterize this modern historical shift in biopolitics as a transition from the problem of anatomy to differences in physiognomy, from the problem of the body to the difference of appearance and skin, color. As race increasingly came to reflect a natural order of the species in the early modern period, race was considered less a verb than a noun. Similarly, color was transformed from an adjective into a noun. Today, we are more accustomed to thinking about race in terms of cultural differences. Even in the face of increasing scientific advancements in genetics and related sciences, in pursuit of a biological basis for and definition of race. Yet even cultural approaches to race tend to configure culture as a static object, culture as something particular racial groups possess, and that certain racial groups must learn to relinquish with great difficulty and consequence. One only need glance at the Moynihan Report from 1965. The Negro family, the case for national action, or, more recently, Samuel P. Huntington's The Clash of Civilizations and the Remaking of World Order, to comprehend straight away how culture becomes a fixed and intransigent thing. Such ossification helps to create and reinforce narratives of racial hierarchy and difference, whether it be in the form of a pathologized black family structure, or a pathologized religion helping to fuel Islamophobia and the war on terror. This history of race as objectification was, of course, always in tension with the fact that the slave was not just an object, but also indeed a subject. An object possessing a subjectivity. In Volume 1 of Capital, Karl Marx explores the nature of commodities, speculating as to what commodities might say if they could speak. The problem of simultaneous objecthood and subjecthood embodied in the personhood of the slave, a commodity that could speak, was a lost opportunity for Marx to contemplate this provocative question in specific terms of race and the transatlantic slave trade. The deleterious effects of this confusion continue to persist in problems of race and racism in our time. The peculiar nature of the race as a speaking commodity allowed Afro-diaspora scholars such as Cedric Robinson to take up Marx's call and to theorize the academic field of what is now known as racial capitalism. The study of the intertwined relationships between race and capitalism in the evolution of U.S. modernity. The field returns us to the problem of universalism and abstraction in modern capitalism and democratic governance, to the American dilemma, in the enduring face of racial particularity, exploitation, and domination. Debates in the field of race studies have often ended in an unproductive intellectual impasse, especially in early American studies, concerning the problem of historical causality. For instance, numerous scholars of early U.S. history have deliberated at length as to whether racism is an effect of slavery as a function of capitalism, or slavery is an effect of racism. David Kazanjian observes that the terms of this discussion have been rather poorly posed, entangled as they are in a mechanical understanding of historical causality. Slavery and race, he notes, are more usefully understood as coextensive formations feeding off of one another and requiring genealogical investigations of effects rather than discrete entities functioning either as cause or effect and requiring presumptively positivist searches for a singular origin. Kazanjian sets a different critical agenda by encouraging us to reframe such chicken and egg debates. He asks us instead to consider how slavery and capitalism were at once animated by and articulated with race and racial nationalism, and to what specific effects. In a similar vein, we ought to consider how race is neither pure objectification nor pure subjectification, but precisely both at once, a continuous modulating relation between object and subject. A coexisting and coextensive formation, a dynamic movement of sociality and causality. In describing race as a relation, as a process rather than a thing, we treat it more as a verb than a noun. For us, race is a performance rather than an essence. Indeed, we might say that race is a historical effect of the social relations between objectification and subjectification. From a slightly different angle, to borrow from Lisa Lowe, race may be considered the historical trace of what remains between the affirmation of a universal, European, liberal human subject and the forgetting of a long history of African slavery, Asian indentureship, and indigenous dispossession on which that universalism was constructed. These ever-shifting social relations are historically contingent, race as a verb, race as historical processes of racialization. Race as relation is thus one key approach to analyzing the subject of racial history. It is useful to consider in greater detail some of the profound and enduring historical effects of slavery and race as coextensive social formations in U.S. politics and law. In jurisprudence, problems of subject-object distinctions appear prominently in property law. We conventionally understand that property as an object that a subject possesses, for example, a house or a car or a slave. An owner, a subject, can purchase or relinquish, buy or sell property at will. Indeed, liberal notions of property emphasize exclusive rights of possession, use, and disposition. Property as, in William Blackstone's words, that sole and despotic dominion which one man claims and exercises over the external things of the world, in total exclusion of the right of any other individual in the universe. As an object, property is not connected to the subject in any intrinsic way. It is, in legal terms, transferable and alienable. To this day, ideas of alienability are at the conceptual heart of our common sense notions of property. Two fundamental shifts in theories of property law are critical to register here. First, in the early 20th century, the jurist Wesley Newcomb Holfeld challenged the conventional idea of property as a subject-object distinction, insisting that property is, in fact, a subject-subject relation, at heart a relational concept. From this perspective, we might suggest that Hofeld's definitional shift of understanding of property law implicitly engages with the critical logics of psychoanalysis. Put otherwise, the owner of a piece of land has not only the legal right to be on it, but also the legal right to exclude others from being on it. In short, property is a subject-subject relation mediated by legal modes of social inclusion and exclusion. Indeed, Hofeld argues that the totality of property relations can be specified through a set of four juristic terms and their opposites. A group of entitlements, rights, privileges, powers, and immunities, and their correlatives, no rights, duties, disabilities, and liabilities. Given the long and continuing history of Black-white racial segregation that overshadows U.S. history and culture, we can apprehend immediately how race might be considered a key term, if not the key term, through which subject-subject relations of trespass, of inclusion and exclusion, of rights and no rights, of privileges and duties, of powers and disabilities, and of immunities and liabilities are mediated and negotiated. Second, in the late 20th century, legal scholars began to challenge the very concept of property as a tangible physical object, a process that the legal historian Thomas C. Gray has described as the disintegration of property. For example, in the age of no-fault divorce, educational degrees and professional certificates, such as medical and law licenses, which are intrinsically connected to the person who earned them, and thus are not alienable in any typical manner as property, began to be considered as a form of property in dissolution of marriage agreements and divorce settlements. Due in part to feminist lawyers and legal scholars who successfully argued that a wife who financially supported her husband during medical or law school is entitled to a part of that degree or license as property. We have more abstract notions of what might be considered property today. In a similar manner, the ever-expanding universe of information technology underscores how intangible things such as computer code, big data, and biometric records are increasingly monetized, valued, and legally protected as property, as abstract and intellectual rather than tangible and physical property. Like educational degrees and professional certificates awarded to particular persons, race is conventionally thought of as inalienable, intrinsically connected to a person's body. Although a long history of racial passing would seem to suggest otherwise. The disintegration of property and jurisprudence opens up a theoretical space to consider how race, too, might usefully be considered as not a tangible thing, but as a type of intangible property, as a relation, as alienable, as a complex range of social and psychic interchanges and experiences. In 1992, critical race scholar Cheryl I. Harris published a field-defining article, Whiteness as Property, in which she argued for the idea of race as a special kind of property right. Harris's article explores how whiteness as property facilitates a long history of subject-subject relations of social inclusion and exclusion, privileges and disabilities, produced and ratified by U.S. law. Harris begins with the idea that the origins of property rights in liberal society are rooted in racial domination, noting that whiteness was the characteristic, the attribute, the property of free human beings. She writes, "The origins of whiteness as property lie in the parallel systems of domination of Black and Native American peoples, out of which were created racially contingent forms of property and property rights. I further argue that whiteness shares the critical characteristics of property, even as the meaning of property has changed over time. In particular, whiteness and property share a common premise, a conceptual nucleus of a right to exclude. This conceptual nucleus has proven to be a powerful center around which whiteness as property has taken shape. Following the period of slavery and conquest, white identity became the basis of racialized privilege that was ratified and legitimated in law as a type of status."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.